Hey there, thanks for joining us for the certification prep session on 70-463, implementing a data warehouse with Microsoft SQL Server. My name is Christopher Harrison. I am owner of Geek Trainer, and oddly enough, that also happens to be my Twitter handle. I'm also a Microsoft certified trainer. And today, I happen to be joined once again by...
My name is Susan Ibach, and I'm also a Microsoft certified trainer, though I hail from the Great White North, known as Canada, and I work for Microsoft these days. And my Twitter handle is Hockey Geek Girl, which, you know, of course, being a Canadian, got to have hockey in there.
And a geek and a girl. So it seems very fitting. All right. So in any event, what we want to do is figure out how to help get you from knowing SQL Server into being certified. So you've been working with SQL Server 2012 for a while, been using DQS, been using integration services, and you've been thinking, you know, it's time I go off and I prove to the world that I actually know what it is that I'm talking about. It's time that I prove that I can do SQL. It's time that I go get certified. So that can be a little bit of a daunting process. So what do you think the steps are to get to there?
Well, yeah, that's an awesome question, because it's different working with SQL and taking that extra step to get certified so you can really show everybody else what you've learned and what you know. And if it really, you can break it down in some really basic steps so that you can sort of, you know, check, done that, and get to that certification. Mm-hmm. So the first one is simply to identify your certification goal. You know, are you looking to get a certified system a solution associate? Are we looking for MCSE? So, you know, we've got different levels we can go to, and of course, different products we want to go to. So you've got to figure out your certification goal and then figure out what exams you have to take to meet that goal. Then you need to find the gaps in your knowledge, because there's a lot of stuff you already know. So the point of your studying should be filling gaps of what you don't know. So you want to figure out what you don't know, find the gaps, and then spend time studying to fill those gaps, which is sort of your step three. And once you've filled those gaps in your knowledge, then you're really ready to go take that exam.
Yep. So let's go ahead and take a look then at step one, which is figuring out what exams need to be taken.
Sure. I mean, if you look at the path here for the MCSA SQL Server 2012, and we're going to make the assumption here that if you're watching the certification prep session for the 463 exam, you're probably going for SQL Server certification. Safe assumption?
I'm going to guess yes.
Yeah, exactly. So for the SQL Server 2012 MCSA, you have to pass three exams. The 461, which is on querying SQL Server, the 462, which is about administering SQL Server, and the one we'll be talking about today, the 463, which is about implementing a data warehouse with SQL Server 2012. And one thing I definitely do want to take a second to point out is the fact that you don't have to take the exams in any particular order. So if you have more expertise in, say, querying, you might decide to actually take the querying exam first. If you have more experience doing the administration tasks, the backups, the restores, the creating tables, you might choose to do the administering exam first. So it's really up to you the order in which you take the exams. When you've passed all three, you've got your certification.
Yep. And you probably want to choose the one that's going to be really the easiest for you to pass, because psychologically, it's just good to have that first pass. So if you're, you know, writing a whole lot of queries, hey, go take that one. If you're doing a lot with integration services, hey, then go take, well, the 463, the one that we're here to talk about today.
Yeah, and one of the things that's nice to sort of give you a heads up on is what to expect when you take that first exam. If you haven't taken one before, you're generally going to see somewhere between 40 to 60 questions on the exam. You're going to have 2 to 3 hours to take the questions and go through all and answer all your questions. And the thing about that 2 to 3 hours that I really want to be clear is you're probably going to find that's enough time. I mean, have you ever actually encountered someone who said, you know, oh, if only I'd had another half hour?
No, I really haven't. I mean, when you first look at it, it might not necessarily seem like a whole heck of a lot of time, but it really is when you get right down to it that I've never taken an exam. I've never talked with anybody who took an exam who said, you know, if I would have just had that extra half hour, I would have done better. I would have passed. Now, speaking of passing, one of the interesting things about all the Microsoft certification exams is the fact that 700 is passing. Now, it's 700, but that's not 70%. That each exam has a what's known as a cut score. It's the minimum number of questions that you have to get right in order to pass the exam. And the way that the score works is it's scaled based against that cut score. So whatever that cut score is, that's 700, and then they scale up and down from there. So 700 is not necessarily 70%.
Right. And the other thing is, don't stress out over feeling, you know, in school it was always a big deal to get the A+.
Yep.
In this case, it really is pass or fail.
Yep.
So all that matters is you pass an exam, whether you get 700 or 980. You passed the exam, it shows up on your transcript, you are going to get to that certification. So don't stress out over 700 versus 980. Your scores are never reported to anybody. You know, it's not like your boss is going to be looking up what your score is on the exam. You will know what your score was,
yep.
But on your transcript, it's simply going to say, hey, you passed.
Yep. Yeah, the only place that your score is ever printed is just on that score report. So as long as you don't give that to anybody, nobody else will know your score. 700 is passing, so it is a pass-fail exam. If you got 750, you studied too hard.
Oh, yeah. And the other thing we should just mention, because I know if you haven't taken an exam before, you get the score report as soon as you're done.
Yep.
So you walk out of the room after taking that exam, and they hand you the piece of paper, and you just go, yes! And when you find out, you passed.
It's that longest, like, 10 seconds from the moment that you click end exam until you finally get your score. It seems like it just takes forever.
Yes, absolutely. Then it does ask you to fill out an evaluation before it shows you your score, and I'm like, that's just me. I just want to know if I passed. Then I'll tell you if I was happy with the exam.
Yeah, there you go. Maybe that's why it's before they show you the score.
Could be.
They might be onto something there. All right. Well, let's go ahead and dig a little bit deeper into the exam itself. One of the things that you're going to notice if you head on over to the URL that's listed down at the bottom is the outline, or what's sometimes known as the objective domain for the exam. And what you're going to see on the objective domain is a breakdown of what's on the exam. In fact, people will frequently ask me, hey, Christopher, what do you use for a study guide? And honestly, this is really what I use, is that I will fire up the objective domain, and I'm going to go through that thing with a fine-tooth comb, and I'm going to be really just brutally honest with myself. And if there's something on there that I don't understand, that I don't grok, I'm going to go back and I'm going to study that. And I'm just brutally honest with myself.
Yeah, no, I'm exactly the same way. No, the exam objectives at that Microsoft Learning site for the exam, that is how you find out what's on exam. It's like a bullet point list saying, here's what's on the exam. And the other thing that's important, if we can actually take a quick look at the percentages there on that slide, you'll notice that there's a percentage for each of the objective areas. And that can be really useful as well, because it gives you a sense of how much emphasis is going to be in the exam for different topic areas. So you take a look at this and you go, wow, loading data, 27%. Almost a third of the questions you're going to get on the exam are all going to be about loading data, which is using your SQL Server integration services to load data. Whereas you look at something like build data quality solutions, you go, that's only 15%. So you're not going to spend as much time studying and looking into that as you should into the loading data.
Absolutely. In fact, if you go kind of just one little step further on this, if you take a look at the numbers, you're going to notice extract, transform data. Well, that's going to be mostly integration services. If you take a look at load data, well, that's going to be a lot of integration services. And then configure and deploy SSIS, I'm going to guess that that's probably also integration services. So I'm doing some real quick math. Carry the one, natural log of pi. 74% of the exam is going to be on integration services. So you might want to go back and double check integration services.
And we might just spend a little more time in this session talking about integration services.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Okay, so we talked a bit about finding the gaps in your knowledge by reviewing those objectives, going through them, reading those bullet points, and looking for the things you haven't explored before. Those are the gaps in your knowledge. Now let's focus on step three, which is filling the gaps in your knowledge. And you're going to be doing that by studying, but we wanted to take a little time today to help you out with that too.
Absolutely, yeah. Hopefully what we can do here is help kind of point you in the right direction as far as where to study, kind of get your brain thinking about what to possibly expect on the exam. kind of go from that input mode to that output mode as far as knowledge goes, and also start to point out maybe some different areas that you don't necessarily deal with on a day-to-day basis, kind of hopefully help you out a little bit, both in your studying and maybe kind of filling a couple of gaps here for you today.
Yeah, so we'll basically go through each of those exam topic objectives and sort of cover each one as we go through.
Exactly. So let's start off then talking a bit about designing and implementing a data warehouse, setting up that OLAP database. So if we take a look here, one of the biggest things that we'll need to pay attention to when we're setting up our OLAP database is dimensions. So we've got a couple of different types of dimensions that we want and schemas that we want to be aware of. We do have what are known as shared dimensions. Shared dimensions are honestly pretty straightforward, just simply a dimension that's going to be shared across multiple cubes that I might eventually be creating. So for example, we might have our different locations. Maybe we've got a table that's got all of our cities and all of our zip codes that I've decided, all right, well, let's just go ahead and create that once. So that way when we're talking about online orders versus our brick and mortar orders, that we can use just that same dimension, or maybe our products, that there's no real need to create multiple tables with all that duplicated data. We've got our star and our snowflake schemas, where our star schema is going to have that one centralized fact table, and the dimensions are going to be on the outside of that.
Right, as opposed to a snowflake schema, where you're really going to have it, and it's actually, based on the way it looks in the picture, this is always how I find it actually really easy to remember star versus snowflake. When you draw out a schema, the star schema, you have that fact table in the middle, and you have the dimensions sticking out, it looks kind of like a star. Whereas when you go with a snowflake schema, what you have is the dimensions are broken out. It's more denormalized.
Yep.
So you actually end up with, you're going to one dimension and then that dimension goes off to another dimension. So effectively you branch out and it sticks out and ends up looking kind of like a snowflake.
Yeah, because no two snowflake schemas are the same.
Oh God, that's terrible. Okay, moving on.
Moving right along. The one little thing that I do want to mention, of course, whenever you're talking about performance and designing everything, is to try and go with a star schema, because the star schema is going to have fewer joins. And that's one of the things that you're looking for when it comes to performance, that the amount of space generally isn't going to be the most important thing. It's going to be how fast can we make it. So I'm willing to sacrifice a little bit of additional disk storage to make our reads that much faster. And so if we can avoid joins, that's going to help make that much faster.
Yeah, that's one of the principles of the data warehouse. Because remember, the problem a lot of, you know, those of you who may not have worked with the data warehouses as much, but if you've grown up with transactional databases, your brain is always normalize my data as best as possible, be efficient about my inserts and my updates, and to save on storage space.
Yep.
But when you're working with a data warehouse, remember it's not being updated all the time.
Yep.
It's being updated at very specific times, and you really are optimizing it for querying.
Yep.
So exactly, a more denormalized database is generally going to be
absolutely. And one of the other things that you do need to pay attention to when you're designing your OLAP database is historical data, or what's sometimes known as a slowly changing dimension. That I may have scenarios where I've got, let's say, customers, and my customer moves from one location to another. Well, when my customer moves, I'm interested in where they currently live when I go pull up their customer record. So inside of an OLTP database, okay, that's all I need, just where are you currently? In an OLAP database, however, I don't care where you are currently. I care where you were when you placed that order. So I want to make sure that I've got that previous value. And so what we're going to see, of course, is that integration services can help us out a bit with that. We'll talk about that in a moment. And we can also implement this on our own by setting up a table, maybe with like a historical set of addresses that I'm going to go ahead and point at, or I might even go ahead and set up date ranges, an active and a deactive range. So that way, when I go in and create my queries, I'll make sure that I'm joining everything up based on the dates, so I can see where you currently or where you were when you placed that order.
Yeah, now you just touched on the slowly changing dimensions. That's something that I know I've encountered a lot of people who struggle with and not entirely sure what slowly changing dimensions are. So let's just take a second and talk about some of the different types of slowly changing dimensions, because I believe, there we go.
Yeah, so when you set up a slowly changing dimension inside of integration services, what it's going to ask you for is a couple of different types of outputs. So we've got a changing attribute, we've got a fixed attribute, and we've got a historical attribute. A changing attribute is one where the value is going to be updated inside of the target database. So for example, this might be the name of the product. So I might not be overly interested when I go run my reports about a name change. Like, I don't care that the product was called a super widget back then, and now it's called an incredible widget. Just the fact that it was, you know, whatever that widget happens to be, if that's the one that was sold, let's just go ahead and display whatever the current name is, and we can move on from there. Contrast that a bit with a fixed attribute. And the thing with a fixed attribute is I don't want to update the target database. So that might be the UPC code, that might be the product SKU, and I don't want that to change. That's going to be my fixed attribute. Last but not least is the historical attribute, and that's typically what you think of when you hear the phrase slowly changing dimension. And again, that's going to be my customer that's moved. I don't care where they currently are. I care where they were when the order was placed for reporting purposes.
Yeah, exactly. Yep.
Yep.
So then we get into things like the fact tables. We just spent some time talking dimensions. So let's focus in on a bit on the fact tables. One of the things we have to think about are what are going to be the appropriate columns that we'd include inside a fact table. So these are typically sort of the data you'd be pivoting on. You'd be doing sums and things like that in your reporting. So, you know, the classic example a lot of us think of is, you know, yeah, you have the customers, you're placing the orders. So on a fact table, I'm going to be looking at, well, what, how much was the total order per product?
Yep.
How much is total order ordered by each customer?
Yep.
So order totals or quantity of a product that was sold make excellent columns for fact tables because I want to look at the trends of those quantities ordered for customers in different cities, in different regions over time. That's
yep.
the type of data I want to report on. So those are the types of columns we typically pick for a fact table. You're probably not going to be postal codes and customer addresses and product names. I don't want to see the trends for different product names per region. Well, I don't want to see product names across different regions as a trend. So it's typically the sort of numerical data that's significant. It really is indicates what's happening with your business in terms of its trends.
Yep. Yeah. And then, of course, when you have your fact table, you're going to be setting up measures to go in and start pre-aggregating all of that. So that way I can see the sum, I can see the average, and so forth. And so you'll notice that those are going to come in a couple of different varieties. We've got our additive, which is most commonly with a sum. And the thing about an additive is that if I have the sum for February, and I have the sum for March, I can just simply add those two together, and I can now see what the total is for February and March.
Now, I was going to say, as opposed to a semi-additive, which is a little bit different, when you have a semi-additive measure, then it might add up over one dimension, but it might not add up over another dimension. So the one I like to think of is units in stock. Units in stock, if you add up units in stock across different warehouses, then it's additive. You're getting the total stock mm-hmm. by adding up the units in stock in warehouses A, B, C, and D. But you talked about adding up across January and February. If I look at units in stock in January and units in stock in February and add those together, that's not really indicating an important value to me. That's not really representative of what's going on in my business or my total stock across the 2 months.
Yep.
So that's a semi-additive measure.
And then the last type that you have is the non-additive measure. And the non-additive measure means that if I got a total for one dimension, let's go ahead and say January, I've got a total for another dimension, let's again say February, that I can't do anything with those two values to come up with a total for January and February. And the most classic example of this is average, that if I've got the average sales for January and I've got the average sales for February, there's nothing that I can do with just the rolled up bit of data there to now come up with a total for January and February, that I can't simply add them up, divide by two. I can't do anything with that. The problem with non-additive measures is, of course, performance, because every time that I'm doing something that wasn't already rolled up for me, SQL now needs to go back and recalculate that for us. So you do want to, as far as performance goes, make sure that you're avoiding non-additive measures.
Yep.
Now, speaking of performance, one of the other very big things that you can do to help improve performance with SQL is create what's known as a column store index.
That's a fabulous new feature. And that's one of my favorites in 2012.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, because what my column store index will do for me is it'll go in and pre-aggregate my data. Now, what's cool about that is it's going to be doing a lot of work, make my queries that much faster.
Absolutely.
The problem, however, is that it's now going to make the data read-only because of the amount of overhead involved there. So if I'm going to set up a column storm index and I now need to do my monthly import of my data, what I need to do is I need to get rid of the column storm index, pull the data down, turn the column storm index back on. If I want to go one step further, maybe help improve performance and not have to get rid of the column storm index every time that I do an import, one of the other things that I can do is I can set up partitions where I will load data into an empty partition, I'll create the column store on that partition, and then go ahead and merge that back into the original table. So it's another way that I can handle
it. Isn't it awesome when like previous SQL Server features that were added that you love get added in and combined to solve solutions with new features that come up. It's love how it's like they planned it.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
All right. Okay. I think we should time to do a let's do a practice question.
Okay.
All right. I think I'll grill you on this one there, Christopher.
All right.
Okay. So right. Let's bring up a little question here. So Christopher, you have a network that contains a server named Server 1, and it's running SQL Server 2012. It contains a database named DB1. Very, hard to keep track of these table names.
These are great names. By the way, don't use these as naming guidelines back in your in your enterprise. Just tip from me to you.
All right. So the schema for DB1 is shown in the exhibit. So you're going to see a schema popping up in just a second. And you want to create a new fact table that's going to aggregate sales information. And you need to identify which columns should be used as measures. So we're trying to identify suitable columns to use as measures or facts. Which of these columns would you identify as measures? So if we can, if you just want to pop up, there's our schema. So take a gander at those columns just to get a feel for it.
Okay.
Then we'll look at your choices for what you would pick as fact measures.
One of the little things just to mention here real quickly is that you may notice on the exam that they do have the little exhibit button. So of course you can click on that, go ahead and pop that up and so forth. One of the things that I find helps me is to just go ahead and draw it out, that sometimes just looking at it on a screen doesn't necessarily click with me, but if I can just take 2 seconds, I can just draw it out, and that will sometimes just make a little bit more sense.
Because you always get given a scratch piece of paper when you're at the exam. You always get a blank sheet which you can draw on while you're taking the exam.
Absolutely, yeah. So if you're anything like me, and I know I am, it might help if you go ahead and just draw that out. Now, we've got that little slide there. Let's go ahead and take a look then at the possible answers here. And so we see things like order quantity, all right, product ID, unit price discount, line total, and carrier tracking number. Now, those are all numbers, which generally speaking, my measures are going to be numbers. It's going to be my numerical data, but not all numbers are created equal. So if I take a look at this, product ID, that's the primary key. Adding that up isn't going to help me anything. All right, so we can go ahead and get rid of that. And I've got my carrier tracking number. Well, I can go ahead and get rid of that. And so kind of taking a little tip here, eliminate those wrong answers. So if you can't spot what the right ones might be, just go ahead and get rid of the wrong ones. So let's go ahead and get rid of those. Look at the other ones. We've got order quantity. We've got unit price. We've got unit price discount and line total. I could definitely see myself running some reports on those. So that's what I'm going to go with is my my final answer there.
All right. And you got it right. Well done.
All right.
Score one for Christopher. All right.
Excellent. Okay.
Okay. So, but we did point out in those objectives that almost 75% of the exam is going to be on SSIS.
Yep.
So let's jump into some topics on that and get into extracting and transforming.
Absolutely. Yeah. So when you're talking about extracting and moving data around, of course, you're going to need to connect to wherever that happens to be. And of course, that could be a file, that could be a SQL server, that could be, Excel.
It's going to be a number of different servers.
Exactly.
You said, flat files, different databases on different servers. You're always, by definition, you're extracting, you're moving things from one place to another. So you're always connecting to this server, this database on this server, and back and forth all the time. So yeah, you got a lot of different connections that you need to keep track of.
And on top of that, those connections are going to potentially change. So we rename our server. Maybe we've decided, hey, you know what? Having it named Server 1 probably isn't the best thing. Let's go ahead and rename this. So now what we need to do is we need to make sure that our package understands, hey, psst, buddy, you want to go over there. That's where the connection manager comes into play. Now, in the past, we've always been able to create our connection managers on an individual package. The nice part about creating it on a package is the fact that it's going to be external, so I could actually update that even though I've already deployed the package, but it's just going to be for that package. Well, let's say that I've got 20 packages that are all going to be connecting to the same database. What I can do is I can create a project level connection manager. So that way those multiple packages can use the exact same connection manager. I make the change in one place rather than in every single location.
Now, I'm going to take the opportunity here to point out one of the things I've learned over the years taking exams, mm-hmm. because project level connection managers, that's new in SQL Server 2012.
Yep.
And one of the things I've discovered, and it makes sense when you think about it, is you tend to get a lot of questions about the new features on the exams. And when you think about it, it makes perfect sense. It wouldn't make sense. I wouldn't want somebody who is an expert on SQL Server 2008 to be able to just walk in and pass the 2012 exam without ever having learned about the features and how to use and work with SQL Server 2012.
Yep.
So how could you have an exam that make sure that somebody, even though they do know the older version of product, can't just pass the new version. You have to ask a fair number of questions about new features. So that's one of my things. Whenever I'm reading those exam objectives, I always sort of go, "Ooh, wait, that's one of the new features."
Yep.
And I always make sure I've taken a glance at those. And
yep.
Project level connection managers is one of them.
Yeah. Now, of course, one of the other very big things is working with data.
Yes. Well, absolutely. Yep. And there's a number of different transformations that you, of course, can use inside your data flow, inside SSIS. So certainly the exam expects you to be aware of the different transformations that you can choose from when you're working inside your data flow. So you've got obvious things like the lookup. So, you know, obviously you'd use a lookup transformation. That's when, you know, you're getting in department IDs, but you need to be able to store department IDs and department names. So you have a lookup transform that's going to go get the department names that go with the department IDs. The conditional split. Sometimes you might be setting up the data and certain data is going to be going to one table, certain data will be going to another table. So the conditional split allows you to literally have the data coming in and then write some sort of condition saying, well, if it's Canadian, then they're a hockey fan, so they go in the hockey table. Whereas if they're an American, they're a football or baseball table, or then we're going to put them to the football and the baseball tables. Of course, now if they are an American, I do want to put them to both the baseball and football tables, so I'm going to need the multicast, which allows me to take data flow coming in and split it into multiple flows. Though in all seriousness, actually that multicast is really useful because you might want to send the data to a database and to a file.
Yep.
Then there's a couple of other split and join transformations as well. Union all basically allows you to take, I've got maybe data coming from one file and data coming from another file, and I want to combine the data from the two flows, join them together into one flow. That's what the union all will do. There's also merge and merge join. Now merge and merge join will also take data from two flows and combine them into one. But, and this is one of those little differentiators that you have to remember when you're taking exam questions, is the merge and the merge join require the data to be sorted before you merge them together. Union all does not require them to be sorted. So that's one of those little differences.
Yep. Now, if we go one step further beyond that and take a look at the BI transformations that we have available to us, one of the items that we have is a fuzzy lookup. And what a fuzzy lookup will do is maybe we're doing it based on states or we're doing it based on countries, and people have typed in different things, like maybe somebody spelled Canada, C-A-N-D-A-A, or, you know, they transposed one of the other letters or left something off. Well, it's a typo, but it is still going to be needed for Canada, so I want to make sure that that gets joined up properly. That's what my fuzzy lookup is going to do for me. Fuzzy grouping, on the other hand, gives me the ability to start doing some manual data cleansing. So, for example, I used to work with an organization where we had a public-facing call center. So somebody would call up and say, hey, you know, I've got this account. And what would often happen is the CSR is just trying to move as fast as they possibly can. So they go to look the person up. They don't find them. So they just simply add in a brand new record. Well, it turned out they were there. They were just mistyping the name.
MacDonald versus McDonald.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So now what we need to do is we need to go and cleanse that, but we do need, you know, a human to go in and help us out a little bit there. That's where the fuzzy grouping comes into play, is that it will create groups. So it will find all the different spellings of Christopher Harrison, put those together into a group, and then I can go in and start cleaning all of that up after that.
Now, another thing, when we think about exams, a lot of times they're going to ask you a question where they'll go, you know, sort of, what is the best answer or what is the best way to do this? Or you might mm-hmm. look at two answers and sort of go, well, maybe I could do it that way. And so performance is one of those things you need to think about when you're trying to think about the best way to do something. If I was given a question and they said, you know, I need to go look up the department name that goes with something, I can do that with a fuzzy lookup or I can do that with a lookup transform. But the fuzzy lookup, because it has to do all that fuzzy logic, it does execute more slowly than the lookup does. In fact, what I usually do in my package is I will actually execute the lookup and then I will use the error redirection to say, hey, if there are any rows you couldn't find, use the fuzzy lookup to see if they have a match. But just one of those little things to be aware of in terms of performance, the fuzzy logic ones do perform a bit more slowly than the straight transforms.
Yep. And then from there, we get into our term extraction and our term lookup. Now, what our term extraction will allow us to do is, let's say that we've got an application to automate handling emails, and what I want to do is just go in and look for trends. That's what my term extraction will do for me, is it will pull out those types of things. So if people are constantly, you know, mentioning the word bicycle, then I can go ahead and pull those out. My term lookup will allow me to go in and start spotting the emails that have bicycle and maybe route them over to the production team, over to the support team, over to the shipping team, based on the different terms that I'm seeing inside of there. Now, you mentioned a second ago about errors.
Yes.
So, obviously, your data going to be perfect. Yeah, I know.
They say, what, there's two costs in life, death and taxes. I would like to add one more. Death, taxes, and bad data.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So, how do you deal with different errors? We've got a slide here. Helps out. Beautiful.
Cool. And there's a few different ones. Now, how you handle the errors depends where you are inside your SSIS package. Let's start with the data flow.
Yep.
You have a data flow. You've got data that's coming in, being sent to a transform. What happens if a transform gets data that it can't handle? What happens if I have a lookup that's trying to look up a department name for department ID and it can't find a match?
Yep.
So one of the things you want to do is you want to create error paths that might redirect that to a fuzzy lookup or might redirect that to a flat file so you know about which records got rejected. But when you create that error flow, don't forget, of course, you also have to configure the transformation itself to specify, hey, when you get an error in this transform, redirect the rows. Don't just fail. You have the redirect rows, and there's also sort of the ignore. If you say the ignore error, it basically pushes the data through, and you end up with null values, generally, is how it'll fill it out.
Yeah, depending on the transformation, the number of times that I forget to go in until I redirect the error rows. And why are you working? Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
The next step down from there is to do that on the control flow, or I guess that would be the next step up the parent. And you do this with precedence constraints.
Yep.
And so based on a precedence constraint for error, I'm going to go this direction. For success, I'm going to go this direction. One of the big things to keep in mind is if I have two separate tasks and they're going to go down into one, what we need to determine is based on those paths, are we going to do an and or are we going to do an or? And meaning that they both have to succeed, complete, or otherwise, or meaning that either side can complete and then we can just roll on from there. So it doesn't necessarily need to wait for the second one to complete. It can just move right on once the first one has flown down to the child.
Right. And then we have the sort of all up, the event handler you can do. And this is one of those ones that the programmers always love, but sometimes people who come from a database background get a little less comfortable with, and that's the ability to just add event handlers. So there is an on-error event handler you can add to your package to simply say, hey, if when you're executing you hit an error, go run this code over here where you can react to it whatever you want, log the error,
send an email.
Yeah, send
smoke
an email, notify an operator by smoke signals.
Yes.
I don't remember that option. I never saw that
really?
API. So the on-error is really useful as well.
Yep.
The other one that might be important to mention too is the whether the parent, like if a component fails, you can also configure whether a component failing will cause its parent container to fail and whether it'll cause its the package to fail. Because that's another important one that affects your output as well. You know, let's say you have a task, which is basically writing information to a log file to say, I've completed. Well, if that fails, do you want to fail the whole package? Do you want to fail the parent container? So whereas if you have a task that is loading your data and that fails, well, at that point, your package has failed. So that's another one. Just be aware of those package propagation options as well.
Yep. Now, sometimes what you're trying to figure out is, okay, well, what went wrong here? That we ran the package, it said that it completed successfully.
Yeah. Never happens.
And then you go look inside your data and you're going, what in the world? And of course, now we need to go in and actually start doing debugging. Now, there's a couple of different options available to us with debugging. If we're inside of the BI tools, then what we can do is we can use the data viewer. Now, the nice part about the data viewer is if I've got my package loaded up and I'm interactively executing it, I can now see, okay, well, what does my data look like? The catch, though, is that it's only going to work inside of the BI tools. What happens if we've deployed it out, everything's been up and running just fine for the last, 4 months, and then we run it and we start to say, wait a minute, that doesn't look quite right. We run it again and it doesn't look quite right. And so now what we want to do is take a look at the data. That's where the data tap comes into play. Now what the data tap will allow me to do is on a deployed package, I can tell that deployed package, take this portion of the data right there, right where I put in the tap. That's my little symbol for putting in the tap. Whatever it is that you put in the tap, to go ahead and write the data out to a text file so I can do that on a deployed package.
And one of those things, that's another one of the new features, just so you know.
Yeah.
Study that one.
On a related note, once we've deployed it out, how do we go about actually executing the package?
Yeah, absolutely. We've got to make sure we can handle the package execution. Now, most of the time when we're creating SSIS jobs, they're going to be scheduled jobs. You're running once a week to refresh your data warehouse or, on weekends when you're doing different activities.
Yep.
So a lot of times you're going to be using SQL Server Agent to schedule those jobs.
Yep.
So certainly you're expected to know, how do I go into SQL Server Agent? How do I schedule a job? What kind of task do I do? And you can generally execute the task either as SSIS tasks or you can execute them as command line and pass it a command. Now, and the command you'd be using would be DT exec. So you are also expected to know, because to be effective in a tool, you should know the different ways you can work things, and scripting is a powerful capability. So DT exec is the command line way of executing a package.
Yep.
There is also DT exec UI. That's one you'd use more interactively because it basically sort of pops up some basic UI options as you go through it, whereas DT exec can actually run unattended.
Yep. Yeah, actually, one of my favorite little things about DT exec UI is really all that it does. It gives you a nice little UI, and then it just creates all the switches for you behind the scenes.
Yeah.
So, which, speaking of switches.
Yes.
Let's talk a little bit about switches. And in fact, I'm going to have you talk a little bit about switches here. So what you're going to notice is that you have an SSIS package named package one. Package one is stored inside of a folder named packages in the D drive. Now you create a variable named var1, you want to execute package 1 from the command prompt. Now you need to pass 1 to var1. What parameter should you use inside of DTExec? Now I'm going to help you out.
Okay.
Because of course nobody sits down and memorizes all the switches.
This is true.
So
we look them up when we need them.
Yeah. Exactly. If you're sitting down and memorizing all the switches, get a hobby.
Yeah.
So because of the fact that nobody's going to sit down and memorize them all, one of the rules with the exam is plausibility, that every answer must be plausible. It must exist in either the current or a prior version of the product. So as you're looking at this, one of the things to focus in on is, all right, well, what makes most logical sense? Because for the most part, it's the one that makes the most logical sense.
If it sounds right, it's not, they're not going to make up a fake answer if it sounds right.
Exactly.
Just to trick me. All right, so
yep.
Give me my choices.
All right, here we go.
Okay.
Here are your choices.
All right, so I have four possible answers here. I have set package. Now, as soon as I see code, or any sort of commands, my first thing I do is I play a little game in my head called play spot the differences. There's four commands here. Do I have to understand the whole command? Right away, I notice A and B say set, and C and D say rem. So immediately, I sort of go, well, if my task was that I need to pass the value 1 to var1, I'm pretty much trying to set a value for the variable, so I'm going to go with set rather than REM.
Okay.
So I'm thinking it's
Although
A or
REM
B.
REM is a great band.
Oh, don't even go there. So I'm going to go with A or B. And then if I look over and again play my little game of spot the differences, I notice the only difference between A and B is whether I should be setting user var1 or system var1. Now, if a system variable, it says I created a variable named var1. Well, if I created the variable, it's not a system variable, so I'm going to go with A.
You're going to go with A? Well, as
I
it
am.
Turns out, you happen to be right. Well done.
Sweet.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
All right. Well, what do you say we turn our attention now to loading data?
Sounds good. Playing around a little more outside SSIS.
Exactly. So what you're going to notice here, just a couple little screenshots to jog your memory, I guess, as far as constraints go. You'll notice, of course, green is, hey, that's where my good data goes, or if we succeed, that's the direction we're going to go. Red, kind of universal for, hey, this is bad, and that's where something failed out that we tried to maybe load data from a database and connection failed or data type conversion failed, and so right. It's going to send the other direction.
Right, and these constraints, which we set in our control flow, are really, really important because this is how we control the flow within our control flow, literally. Yep. So this is where, you know, you have a task executing inside your control flow, and you may have multiple tasks actually running at the same time in parallel, try and be more efficient. You know, you're extracting data from over here, extracting data from over here, extracting data from over here. I can have those all happening at the same time.
Yep.
So you might have multiple control flow tasks occurring at the same time, but you can specify when they're done. Maybe you have a step that simply says log the results or specify the task was completed or notify the operator but everything's good. So you have your constraints connecting to that finishing task. And you can actually specify if that task should be completed when the others are done successfully, or if you just execute them when the other task is completed, success or fail, or you can say execute if there was an error, which is actually great error handling. So it allows you to sort of say, hey, if there's an error, actually, maybe I'm going to send a different message.
Yep, absolutely. Now, one of the other things that you're going to do when you set up your packages is deal with variables. Now, variable, of course, is just simply a variable, placeholder for a value. So with my variables, the biggest thing is to ensure scope, that I
can... Yes, get the scope right.
Yeah, absolutely. I can create my scope at an individual task level, I can create it at a container level, or I can create it at a package level. As a best practice, you want to create it at the lowest possible level, because then that way it's going to limit the chances of something else coming along and modifying that value, and now all of a sudden it's not set to whatever it is that I was expecting. You'll also notice inside of integration services, and it's one of my favorite little features, is the expression.
Yeah, I love expression. It's so powerful when you start playing it.
It really is, because it gives you the ability to just on the fly dynamically set basically any property that you might want to a value from basically anywhere that it might be. So if you need to dynamically figure out a directory path, if you need to dynamically figure out really kind of anything else, your expressions will allow you to do
that. Yeah, because you can create an expression that reads the variable and that allow and set the property based on that expression which read a value from a variable. So yeah, you can dynamically change the values of just about any property at all.
Yeah. Now, one of the cool things that SQL 2012 or SSIS 2012 introduced is the ability to have parameters. Now, what parameters allow you to do at the project level is store values and be able to have packages inside of that project point back to those parameters. So one centralized location. Now you're going to notice, of course, it's going to be defined using a different window, project.params. The big thing is when you deploy it. Because if I deploy out the individual package, it's going to be pointing at a parameter that hasn't been deployed. So you do need to use project deployment so that way all my parameters will make the trip. And so now our package will actually be pointing at something worthwhile.
Oh, and if I could steal the camera just for a second. It's a new feature, so study it. Okay, moving on. We're good now. Go back. Back to the slide. We're good.
Sorry, I'm going to need a second there. Anyway, what happens if it turns out that whatever it is that you're trying to do inside of integration services isn't built in? Well, fortunately, as it turns out, you can implement your own code and utilize the script component.
Right. So you've got a few different ways that you can have sort of custom code, so to speak, executing in your tasks. Yeah. So there may not be a transform task that's going to do what you need to do. So you can use a script task, which basically can execute VB script that'll do something. And you can also, of course, interact with variables. There might be variables that you are only reading inside your task, and there might be times when you actually want to modify your variables. You will have to specify that when you configure your task, when you access, say, I want to access this variable in my task, and you'll have to say, I'm accessing it for read, or I'm accessing it for read-write, otherwise you get errors.
Yep.
And, of course, you can also even access external DLLs.
Absolutely, yeah. The one catch with an external DLL, though, is that it does have to be deployed out to the global assembly cache. It does need to go out to the GAC. How about transactions?
Okay. Well, anytime you're talking data, obviously you have to be thinking a bit about the transactions.
Yep.
So there's a few things we need to think about. You can create sequence containers in your control flow that contain multiple tasks, and you can specify in the sequence container that it is requires a transaction. And if you create a sequence container and you say it requires a transaction, then at that point, then you're saying, hey, we can't do the commands in here unless the transaction's been started. So when I start that task, if there isn't a transaction, it's going to create a transaction at that point. And then if an error occurs when it's inside that container, it would then roll back the transaction. Or if everything completes successfully inside that container, then at that point, it's going to commit the transaction. So that's a nice way of saying, hey, make sure it's an all or nothing deal.
Yep.
But you can also do it by just using an execute SQL statement. You can actually create a SQL task that says, go in and say begin tran, and then commit tran, and you can write the code to do it yourself. But don't forget, if you're using execute SQL tasks to do your begin and commit tran, you do have to tell them to run on the same connection, because otherwise it releases a connection. You have to set the retain connection property to true on those execute SQL statements.
Yep. Absolutely.
I was going to say, and the performance. There is something to think about in terms of performance on this, too.
Yeah, that if you can get in and just do everything inside of one statement, kind of one normal SQL statement, as opposed to I've got task, 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 task. If I have task, 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 and all of that is one transaction, that's going to take longer for execution than if I do everything inside of one balled up SQL statement. So if you can just do it inside of one balled up SQL statement and send that up, that's going to perform faster.
Right. And in addition to that, there's another thing that I don't think a lot of people may not be aware of, but it is in terms of best practice to be aware of. When you use the container and you say transactions required on that container, it actually creates a distributed transaction. If you don't need a distributed transaction, that's a small performance hit. So just something to be aware of. So those basic options, just if we bring up the slide for a second, there's three options you can set on your container. It can say a transaction required, which means if there isn't a transaction, it's going to start one. You can say a transaction supported, which means, well, if somebody has started a transaction, hey, I'm in, I'll be part of that transaction, or you can say that it's not supported, so it will not be part of the transaction.
Yep. And then finally, on the failure option side of things, you'll notice that I can configure an individual task to fail the package, which of course will just bail out of the package, or I can tell it to just simply fail the parent and then let the parent decide what it wants to do, if it's going to continue, if it's going to redirect maybe to a different task for error handling, or if it is in turn going to fail the package.
Yeah.
You know, I got to tell you, Susan, it's little things in life that make me happy. One of the little things inside of integration services that I just love is the for each.
You know, I love for each in .NET. I love for each in integration services, too.
I'm absolutely
100% with it. It's one of those ones you think you're going to have to write it all yourself with like a for loop and then write a bunch of file readers. And then you find for each and you go, thank you.
Yep. Yeah, the whole thing with for each is just like it sounds, for each X that it finds, it's going to do something. So I've got a directory full of, in this case, spreadsheets, and I need to just act upon each one of them. That's exactly what the for each loop is going to do for me.
Yeah, I can have, there's different types of for eaches, so you should just be aware of some of the different ones. So you can have a for each. There's one which, you know, will go through all the records that are returned by a query. You have one which might execute for each file in a directory.
Yep.
So there's a few different ones you should at least review the different choices, and oh, they're just fabulous.
Yep. So one of the challenges that you wind up running into when you're dealing with moving data and bulk loading data is what happens if we are halfway through and something goes wrong.
Yeah, I used to run into this all the time, actually. We had a project we worked on where the first step in our basic loading of our data was we had to go extract the data from one server.
Yep.
Then we, after our extract was done, we would then copy it to a new server, and then we would do the load. And basically, you know, pretty straightforward, pretty common scenario.
Yep.
But one of the things that would sometimes happen is, of course, the most common thing to fail was the load. And then we had a very fixed window in which to do our work. So this is what we had to deal with, is what if the extract and the copy worked fine, but then the load fails? We don't want to redo everything.
Yep. Yeah, and this is where our checkpoints come into play. Now, what a checkpoint will allow me to do is to write out, well, a checkpoint file. And then should my package fail, it will go to the checkpoint file and figure out where to start up. Now, the way that this is going to need to be configured is I am going to need the option to, of course, save checkpoints, specify wherever you want to write the file out to, and then you're going to notice my checkpoint usage, and I've got never, always, and if exists. So never, sort of like the name implies, is going to ignore it. If exists, again, sort of like it implies, would use it if it exists. Always means that it must use a checkpoint file. So it's nice if maybe an earlier execution had failed. I went in, realized, oh, wait a minute, that's my fault. I've got a problem. I go in, fix the problem inside the package. I redeploy it, and I want to make sure that it picks up from where it left off. So I can go in, set the checkpoint option to be always, so now it's going to fail unless it finds that checkpoint file. So that way I don't accidentally, because I made a change, redeployed it, do the whole thing all over again. Now, one little note about checkpoints is that they're not honored for loop containers. So if I've got the for each or I've got a for loop, my checkpoint is not going to be honored there. So if maybe we've done something 5 times out of 100 and that fifth time failed, it's not going to be able to pick up with step 5. It's going to start all over again.
All right. Now, since we're talking about checkpoints, I want to touch on something here, which I know the first time I started working with checkpoints, it wasn't intuitive to me how you actually set a checkpoint. So I've actually got a question for you here, which kind of revolves around that.
This doesn't sound good.
Yeah. I'm going to get you here. All right. So you have a package named, go for it, package one. Package one performs bulk inserts into a dimension table by using a separate bulk insert task for each dimension. We have checkpoints implemented in the package. You want to be able to restart the package when a bulk insert command fails, and you want to avoid reloading the data for inserts that were successful. So, classic checkpoint scenario. You need to configure the package to support your goals. What settings should you enable?
Well, let's see. We've got set fail package on failure to true, to false, to none, and to failure. And then we've got this maximum error count property to a high value.
And I bet you thought there was just going to be something called checkpoint on.
Yeah, wouldn't that have been nice? Okay. So a couple of real quick strategies that I'm going to use here. Number one is you're going to notice that we've got the little text there that says each answer represents part of the solution. Choose two. Ah, okay. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm immediately now in my head going to start figuring out, okay, well, which two are going to come together, so I only need two. That maximum error count, that doesn't look right at all, so I'm just going to get rid of that one. Let's just get rid of that one. So now we've got our fail package on failure set to true or false. You know, it would seem to me that if the checkpoint is going to work, we should just fail the package on failure so that way it would actually write to it. So I'm going to say true there, and then you'll notice the force execution result to none or to failure. Well, failure means that it's going to forcibly say, hey, this is a failed problem. None seems to imply to me that it's just not going to say anything. It's not going to force an execution result. It's just going to use the natural execution result that it came up with. So if it turned out that it failed, then it just simply returned out that it failed. So that's going to be my final answer. It's going to be A and C. Okay. And if we take a look, whoops, let's get to the right section here. There we go. Little animation challenges. Can you tell we're database people and not PowerPoint.
Yes, exactly.
People here.
Awesome. But yes, you are correct.
We're keeping our tradition alive of having something go sideways.
Yeah, we have
with
to have at least one slide messed up on every presentation.
Yep. Yeah, so this will be our one messed up slide. But am I correct?
You are. It is, in fact, A and C. You got that exactly right. Force execution result, property to none, because if you set that to failure, you would be forcing it to fail, which is obviously not. That's something we do generally for testing. It's not something that we do to set checkpoints.
Yep.
You might use that to test a checkpoint, but not in production when you're actually executing the package.
So, yeah, if we want to see that again real quick, there we go. Okay. Yep. So true and none.
Perfect.
Excellent. Okay. Well, let's talk a little bit about taking the packages that we've created and actually getting them up into SQL. Now, whenever we're executing packages, don't you think it's kind of important to see how a package executed behind the scenes?
Absolutely, because one of the things that these are typically running unattended, scheduled events over the weekend, and there's nothing like coming in Monday morning and having people yelling at you saying, how come my data isn't there? I entered this last week and I can't see my data in this report. So log providers are really, really important in integration services, and the great flexibility of all the different log providers we can choose from. So we get a lot of built-in capabilities where we can say, hey, when you're running, I would like to log this information, and you get to choose what information you're going to log. You get to say, oh, I want to know when this task runs, I want to know if there's errors, or I want to know all the information I can when this particular task runs. So you have quite a lot of control over how much information there is.
Yep.
And then you also get to control where the output's going to be sent. So if we take a look at the different choices of log providers, you can send your output to a text file. You can send it to SQL Server Profiler, which is basically going to give you a trace file. You can send it to SQL Server itself into tables. The Windows event log, an XML file, or you can even create a custom log provider. Though, to be honest, with all those other choices, I would try to stay away with custom unless you really need it.
Yeah, and in fact, if I can go one step further, if I can pivot just slightly on that, whenever you're looking at an exam, just like the real world, simplest thing that works. Prize simplicity. So if you see that you've got option A, option B, option C, and option B and C involve, you know, this long, drawn-out path, having to climb a mountain, go talk to you know, some mystic up there, go with whatever the easiest thing is going to wind up being, and that is most likely going to be the correct answer in both the exam as well as in any of your real-life solutions.
Yeah. So now, in terms of our deployment options, and just a second, there's a new feature. Project deployment. It's new. You want to know this one. So we were about to talk about deployment options, weren't we, Christopher?
Yes, as a matter of fact, we were. So you'll notice that we've got a couple of different deployment options. We've got the old DTUtil command line. By the way, again on command line, make sure that you glance over the different switches that are available to you. We've got our deployment wizard, which will allow us to deploy out our package, change things as we deploy it out. Then finally, again, that project deployment that just right from inside of the BI tools to simply right-click on the project, just say deploy, and away it goes. And that will send up not only the entire project, but it will also send up any of your project parameters as well. And in fact, speaking of new features, is a little thing called a build configuration.
Sorry, did you say a new feature?
I did say
okay,
a new feature.
Okay, a new feature. All right, so maybe we should talk about that.
Yeah, let's talk about that. So the build configurations allow me to set different values depending on where I'm going to deploy this out to. So I can create a configuration for dev, for staging, for production, and when I go to deploy from a little drop-down list, I just choose the configuration that I want, and it will make sure that all my values, so for example, my server names, are set to the appropriate values for that particular environment, and I can do that with build configurations.
Yep.
I can also do that with environmental variables. So my environmental variables, easy for me to say.
Apparently not, actually, but go on.
My environmental variables allow me to store change values inside of the SSIS catalog. Now, the big thing about my environmental variables is the basic steps. You have to create the environment for your variables and for the packages. You need to set up your variable and then create a reference to the variable from the package. Now, speaking of the SSIS catalog, there's a lot of views and stored procedures that are available to us to manage that SSIS catalog.
Right, because in the past, I mean, you know, the packages have always been stored inside the MSDB,
yep.
But this whole SSIS catalog, that's
much more powerful. It gives me a lot more control over how I want to store and manage all of those. So this is where we're going to need more advanced tools. We've got our different store procedures. We've got our different views. Now, the goal of this slide here is not in any way, shape, or form to be exhaustive. I'm not going to sit here and go through each one of these, read all of these to you. I don't think that's great use of anybody's
time.
Well,
the other thing, too, is honestly, when you see the name, I find, of these system store procedures and system views, a lot of times the names are fairly, I'm going to guess that, you know, move project has something to do with moving projects, and create environment store procedure might possibly help you create environment.
Just maybe.
Or create an environment.
Just maybe. So one of the things that you want to focus in on, going back again to the exam, going back to plausibility, is that it has to exist. So what you'll want to do is make sure, again, you kind of go back, refresh these, but just keep in mind that whatever we're talking about, it does have to exist.
Yeah.
So, Susan.
Yes.
I'm going to put you on the spot now.
Okay.
Now it's your turn.
Fire away.
All right. Here we go. So, got a question. We have 200 SSIS packages on a server named, would you believe,
Server 1.
We've got a user named would you believe?
User one?
He had some really weird parents. Needs to be able to view all existing packages in server one and manage their own packages. You need to add user one to a database role that allows user one to comply with the requirements. You must ensure the user has no additional permissions. What database role should you add user one to?
All right. Well, I'm going to use a little of my knowledge of, you know, best practices in terms of things, which is I know, and they even specify here, you must ensure the user has no additional permissions.
Yep.
But even if they don't say that, I know good security principles.
Yep.
You never give somebody more permissions than they need.
Yep.
So as soon as I see D, database owner, I'm like, that's gone. Why would I give someone database owner permissions if all I want them to be able to do is view existing packages and manage their own packages? So
yep.
DB owner is way too much power if that's all I want them to do. And I feel the same way about SSIS admin. So at that point, I just have to go, oh man, I remember studying this earlier. What, which one was the user and which one was the operator? What could they do? But it is, in fact, the operator that allows you to view and manage your own packages. So I'm going with operator.
Final answer?
It is my final answer.
And as it turns out, you are correct. Well done.
Now, one of the things is this is one of those ones where, honestly, you just flat out have to memorize it. There are going to be a few of those where
yep.
there's a bit of memorizing involved. So one of the tricks I use is when I'm actually taking the exam or studying for the exam and I see something like, oh, what are the different roles and permissions that I can grant to people? Which one's user, which one's operator? So I'll be studying that and I'll write it down on a piece of paper and I'll have a little sheet of the things I just have to memorize. And I can bring that with me and even 5 minutes before the exam, I can go through that sheet and review it. Now, I can't bring my sheet of paper with my notes into the exam room.
Wouldn't that be nice?
Yeah, I think that would be cheating.
Yeah, that might be cheating.
Yeah, that's not really the intention.
No.
So you can't bring that sheet of paper in with you, but what you can do is you can actually, you know, read it just before you go in, crumple up that piece of paper, toss it out. You'll be taken into the exam room, sit down, and then they give you a pad of paper or a scratch sheet. So while it's still in my brain, I can take that piece of paper and I can write it down while I still remember it.
Yep.
So that's a trick I've used on occasion when I'm going through the exams.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's one of my favorite little things because if you write it down right in advance, then you're not under pressure. So when the question does come up, it's just as simple as basically a lookup like, oh, okay, that's right. There it is. So yeah, those types of facts that you just have to memorize, write it down. Once you walk in, you hit start on the exam.
All right, we don't have a ton of time, but I do want to see if we should get at least a little bit into the data quality solutions.
Yeah, let's go talk a little bit about data quality services. Let's talk just a little bit about getting that deployed out. So first up, the prerequisites for installing DQS. What you're going to notice on the server side, that we do need, you know, 2 gigs of RAM, 4 gig recommended. I'd rather see you have more than that, but that's a conversation for another time.
Yeah, really, how often do we run production stuff on 4 gig of RAM?
Yep, but
anyway,
absolutely.
But anyway, for the purposes of what is minimum required, there you go.
Absolutely. You do need, the SQL Server database engine does need to be 2012, does not work with a prior version, so you will need SQL Server database engine installed. As far as the client goes, you will need .NET 4.0, you are going to need IE 6.0 Service Pack 1 or later. One little thing to note about .NET 4 is if you haven't already installed it, when you run the installation for the client, it will automatically install it. Now, when you actually go to perform the installation of DQS, it's a little bit funky how it works. What you're going to do is you're going to select DQS from the installer screen, but all that it's going to do is just copy DQS installer to the directory that SQL is in. Then what you need to do is run the DQS installer after that. So after you run the setup, then go ahead and run it. And then you've got the different permissions that you can go in and set up. So if you want to set up your knowledge base editors, operators, or an administrator, add the appropriate roles to, or the appropriate people to the appropriate roles. Then as far as the client goes, to install the DQS client, what I'm going to do is, again, grab that proverbial SQL 2012 DVD, pop that into the drive, choose the DQS client. You do not need to install the Management Studio, but you definitely want to consider installing it now. Along those same lines, let's go back and just touch on one other very big thing for the exam. What you want to do whenever you're answering a question is answer the question. don't overthink it. So if you're going in and you're going, well, you know, I'd also like this and I'd also like this, if the question is, hey, all you need is just the bare minimum required does not include the management studio.
Good point.
All right.
So we've kind of covered all the different areas. Let's just sort of take a step back at those original steps we were discussing.
Yep. Take a step back and look at the steps.
Yes, let's see where we're at.
Yes.
So you're here listening to the session. So at this point, you should have your certification goal of an MCSA SQL Server 2012.
Yep.
And what you know what exam you need to take. If you're here now, you're probably preparing for that 463 exam about the data warehouse. Finding gaps in your knowledge. That's something you're going to have to do on your own. You need to go look at the objectives for the exam on the Microsoft Learning site and go into that, read through those objectives, and look for the things where you go, wow, you know, maybe you've never played with data quality services, so then you're going to need to read up on that. Or maybe you're going to take a look at and discover that there's certain transformations they talk about. Maybe you've never tried the fuzzy lookups and groupings inside integration services, or you don't know how to configure these new environments and so on. So find out what you don't know. Then you're ready to go to step three and fill the gaps, because now you want to do effective studying. Hopefully we filled a few gaps for you guys here today. We were hoping to do a little bit of that for you, but you're probably still going to need to take a step back and actually do a little studying on your own as well. And then finally, you're ready to go take that exam.
Yep. So when it comes to the exam, beforehand, what you want to do is set a date. If you just simply say, you know what, I'm going to get around to taking the test at some point, you're not going to. That's just the simple fact of life. So what you want to do is circle a date on the calendar, call up Prometric, and say, hey, this is when I want the when I want to take my exam. Because now that'll set that mental bit switch. It makes it real, I think.
Well, the other thing is there'll never come a day where you go, I am 100% sure I'm going to pass that exam. Let's go. I want to take it now. That's not going to happen. So the best thing to do is you'll get to a point where you just say, hey, you know what? I've studied. I think I'm ready. I'm going to try the exam. So set yourself a date. So don't feel like you have to be, you know, going in there thinking I'm going to get 100%. There comes a point where you just have to go give it a try.
Yep, absolutely. Absolutely. In fact, of all the exams that I've ever taken, which is a lot, we actually had to look it up at one point. It was like 55 or something amazing like that. But only once have I ever hit 1,000.
Wow.
So always gotten at least one question wrong.
Yeah.
We'll talk about, you know, dealing with those types of things in just a moment here. But one of the other very big things is to set small goals. So if I just simply decide, it's going to be 3 months out, then I start to get a little bit complacent. What I want to do is set small goals. So by the end of next week, I want to understand all the different types of BI lookups. So my term extraction, my fuzzy lookups. I want to learn how to do all of those. So I want to set smaller goals.
Another simple thing, and this is just such a simple thing to do, is just get a good night's sleep before the exam. You know, you're not going to be prepping the exam in one day. So staying up till 3 in the morning probably is not helping you.
Nope.
You need your brain to be fresh when you go take that exam. So get a good night's sleep. And, you know, if you know it, you already know it. That extra cramming the night before is probably not going to help you out too much.
Nope, not at all. The other very big thing is once you start the exam, don't panic.
So true, really.
Yeah, nobody's going to beat you with a stick. The absolute worst thing that's going to happen, don't get me wrong, it stinks. I mean, we've all failed exams. It stinks is you're going to get that little piece of paper that's going to have a number that's smaller than 700, and you're going to have to go back and you're going to take it again. You've lost a bit of time. In the grand scheme of things, it's not that bad. Don't panic. Now, about that time, I know we said earlier, don't worry too much about it, but you should really at least keep a bit of an eye on time, kind of see where things are.
Yeah, I mean, it's not something where, said, you should be stressing out thinking, oh my gosh, I only have 3 hours to do this exam, I'll never finish it. So you're not going to spend, I said, it's highly unlikely that I've yet to meet someone who said, if I just had more time, I would have passed. But it is certainly worth taking a glance up, you know, maybe when you've done 10 questions, just take a quick glance up and see how it's going.
Yep.
And usually, if you are behind on time, it's because you've spent too long on a particular question. So you might hit a question where you're going, I don't know this one, and you sit there and you stare at it, and you stare at it, and you reread it, and you change it to C, and then back to A, and then back to C again, and then you go, wait, maybe it's B, and you find yourself just stressing over that one question. When that happens, you can actually mark a question for review, and you can go past that question and then come back to it later. So don't spend And if you can't answer that question in a few minutes, move on and come back to it later.
Yep. And then as far as those tough questions,
yep.
One of the big things that you want to do, of course, is eliminate wrong answers. That one of the things that you'll potentially be able to do is get rid of one right away, maybe even two possible wrong answers. And sometimes I might have four possible answers. I've been able to get rid of three. So even if I don't know what that last one is, if it's the only one left, it's got to be the right answer.
Yeah. There's always going to be some questions you don't know the answer to when you take the exam. It's just that's the way it is.
Yep.
Don't go in there expecting to score 1,000, even if you've studied a ton. You may have gotten 1,000. I've never gotten 1,000 on an exam yet. And I feel pretty confident when I walk to the exams, and I know the product pretty well.
Yep.
I passed, but I'm not scoring 1,000. So there are always questions. Sometimes the first five questions I get in the exam, I'm like, oh, I don't know. And I get all, that's when I start to panic and I have to calm down. But then I get to the next questions and I start getting some answers.
Yep.
But that eliminating wrong answers is a great strategy.
Yep.
That making sure I don't get stressed out and spend too much time on the one question. And the other one, when all else fails, guess.
Yeah. Remember that what's going to wind up happening with every single question is you're going to get 1 point if you get it right. You're going to get 0 points if you get it wrong or leave it blank. So to review, if I mark an answer, one of two things will happen. Something good, I get a point, or something bad, I get 0 points. If I leave it blank, I'm guaranteed something bad is going to happen. I'm going to get 0 points.
So play the odds.
Exactly. Give it a shot. Guess. You never know. You might just get it right.
All right. So when we're done here, one of the things you're going to need to do, said you're going to need to spend some time on your own going off, finding the gaps in knowledge, and then spend some time studying to fill the gaps in knowledge. So we want to point you to a couple of resources that might help you out when you're studying.
Yeah. So first of all, for the just registering for the exam itself, real quick, is www.permetric.com, or I'm sorry, www.permetric.com. And then to prepare for the exam, you're going to notice the URL right there for pulling up the exam guide.
Yep.
You're going to notice the Microsoft official courseware for implementing a data warehouse with SQL Server 2012-10777.
Right. So that's if you can actually go off and actually take a course to help you prepare. That's the best course to help you prepare. And finally, there is actually a training kit that's published by Microsoft Press, which is actually designed to help you master the material for this particular exam.
Absolutely. And so with that, we want to wish you guys good luck.
Yes. Good luck. Go take the exam and rock it.
All right.